Hi, my name is Krisztian Fekete, and this presentation is called Adopting Thanos Gradually Across All of LastPass Infrastructures. You can see the agenda of this presentation on this slide. First, there will be a short introduction of me and the company and the product I'm working at. Then, I'm going to walk you through our situation and the problems that led into introducing Thanos to our tech stack. Then, we will discuss the planning and preparation phase. And we will arrive at the actual implementation phase. And I will conclude this presentation with some statistics and results and some future plans. I'm Krisztian Fekete and I'm working at LogMeln on the product called LastPass as a DevOps engineer. We, as the DevOps team, are responsible for developing and maintaining the infrastructure under the LastPass components. LastPass is the market leader password manager. Out there you can generate, store, share passwords and documents with your friends, family and coworkers. And recently we've added dark web monitoring functionalities as well to get you notified about relevant data breaches to keep you safe online. We have millions of users, enterprise customers, and we are serving thousands of requests at any second. So, let's see how it all began. We have an extensive set of infrastructures and services. We are using AWS, Azure, DigitalOcean. We are present on on-premise data centers across continents. We have Kubernetes clusters, Puppet Manage, virtual machines. We are using managed services like databases, message queues, and functions. Our on-premise data centers are fully functional by themselves. These are not containerized and they have a single Prometheus instance to scrape all the targets, and we have 60 days of retention. On the other hand, we have Kubernetes clusters, and these are multi-tenant clusters, so we have different and multiple applications and services deployed into these. The monitoring aspect is a bit similar, was a bit similar because we ran a single Prometheus instance in these clusters and we have 30 days of retention. It's lower than what we had in the on-premise data centers because the characteristics of the metrics traffic is different. For example, we have more frequent deployments on these clusters and we are using Istio, and that's responsible for a lot of high cardinality metamatrics. What were we missing in this setup? We had a few rare Prometheus restarts, especially on our on-premise data centers, and when it happened it took quite long to replay the write-ahead log, so we wanted to have highly available redundant Prometheus instances. We wanted to have a scalable metric store behind these instances. We wanted to be able to craft queries reaching from Kubernetes clusters to on-prem metrics, and we wanted to have a long-term storage. So how did we solve all this? We solved it with Thanos, but this is not the end of the presentation because it wasn't this easy. Let's take a look at our preparation phase next. We decided to go with these steps as planning and preparation. We first wanted to collect our problems, set goals and scope for this project. Then we could choose a solution that fits our planned scope. Finally, we could break down these into tasks and identify the dependencies between these. About collecting our problems. I already mentioned our pain points earlier. We wanted two highly available Prometheus instances, cross-infrastructure queries and alerts, really long-term storage, and we are before cloud migration, so we wanted to have a solution that is scalable and have active community and support. Our problems are solvable with vanilla Prometheus to some extent, but if you have ever set up a federation with multiple layers, you know you will end up in federation hell quite soon. It will be hard to maintain and you will want to solve all of our recently mentioned problems. You will have to reinvent the wheel a few times with federation. Also, we like to build our own platform, so we decided not to use a managed third-party monitoring service for this purpose. So this left us with these four projects to choose from: M3 by Uber, Thanos, Cortex, Victoria Matrix. Choosing between these, and in fact between any technologies, can be daunting and a hard task. So first we took a look at some GitHub statistics to get a basic idea about the actual landscape. You can see some of the fields of this table highlighted with colors. These can indicate red flags and green flags for certain aspects, for certain attributes of these projects. But this was not enough to choose a technology. We spent some time comparing these projects against each other and against our goals, and you can see the simplified version of the final results on this slide. M3 is not a widely adopted solution, so we decided to not to go with that. Victoria Matrix seemed to be great first, but after some research it turned out it's not fully compliant against Prometheus remote write specifications, and there's a few posts listed in the footer. Please dive into those if you are considering adding Victoria Matrix into your Prometheus ecosystem. Next one was Cortex. Cortex seems to be great, but it's a bit complicated. It's more fitting for really large matrix warehouses, and it's more enterprisey with its NoSQL dependency, but this might be abandoned at some point. There are also some blog posts on the plans for Cortex, so I can recommend checking those out. But overall, it's a fine solution that is compatible with the Prometheus ecosystem. And finally, there's Thanos. Thanos is also CNCF incubated. It has components that are pluggable in a phased manner, so you can start experimenting with these and adding the next one when you see fit. And it's reusing Prometheus code, so it's fully compatible with the Prometheus ecosystem. After we had the technology, we could break this down into tasks. We wanted to have environment parity, so we wanted to have a development observer cluster that will host this whole Thanos setup. We decided to host it on a Kubernetes cluster, so that was the first step. Then we could move forward to cross-cluster integration with the development observer cluster. That is the development cluster that is running the business workloads. And after checking the documentation for Thanos, we saw that there's Thanos receive, which is a somewhat new feature component that is addressing egress only tenant integration, and we decided to use this to integrate our on-premise data centers. After that, we wanted to have monitoring and alerting, and finally post-configuration sizing, performance and load testing was the only things that left, and if all worked great, we could move into production. Now we will go through the actual implementation phase and the issues that we faced during that section. We had this first question: should we use Istio? We are intermediate Istio users with almost 2 years of operational experience, so we could list the pros and cons. As I mentioned, we are fairly advanced users. We are using MTLS ingress gateways as ingress to our service mesh. We are using the telemetry modules, the Istio metrics that this module is providing. We are using various invoice filters, tracing, so we have seen the benefits of what Istio could offer. But how much of these features would be needed for Thanos? And it turned out not that many, because yes, we could use ingress gateway as ingress to the mesh and to Thanos, We could use the streamlined MTRs that Istio is providing, but with Istio we would also have an additional layer because of the sidecars, the invoice sidecars. And we can work this out and fine-tune this to have a simplified tunnels deployment, but it's faster and better to skip these if these are not needed. Same with the extensive set of high cardinality metrics, meta metrics. These can also be worked out, but if we are not benefiting from these metrics, we can also skip these. And of course, introducing Istio means introducing an additional dependency with its own lifecycle. We have to upgrade it from time to time if Istio or its dependencies are vulnerable to certain security issues. We can patch these as soon as possible because it's running production and business critical workload. So we decided not to use Istio under Thanos. How Thanos works. This illustration is a simplified version of the one that you can see on the official Thanos GitHub repository. I created this to make it a bit less scary. We have basically Thanos sidecars running next to the actual Prometheus instances. These sidecars can upload the metrics to an object store. We are using AWS, so we choose an S3 bucket to store these metrics. Thanos Query is a central component of the Thanos ecosystem. It can query store API. It can query components that are exposing store APIs, for example, Thanos sidecars, so you can access the data behind the Prometheus instances. And there's Thanos store gateway that makes the object store accessible and queryable to Thanos Query. And we can also compact this data with Thanos Compactor. It's not needed at first, but if you are planning for long-term storage, it's a great component to add to have your metrics compacted. So the initial Thanos deployment in our development observer cluster looked somewhat like this. We first wanted to extend our CloudFormation template for our EKS clusters to have separate observee and observer roles. Basically, with this we solved that observer clusters can provision S3 buckets for long-term storage and the IAM roles for the Thanos and Prometheus components to use and reference it as service accounts. After that, we could actually deploy the development observer cluster. Once we had that cluster, we could deploy meta monitoring. We are using the Kube Prometheus stack helm chart to have the Prometheus ecosystem deployed. After that, we could deploy Thanos. We are using the Bitnami Thanos helm charts for this purpose. And we can start out by making the meta monitoring of the observer cluster highly available. Using this approach, we are not risking basically anything because that's only an empty cluster running tooling. So we can so if we encounter any issues, we can work this out without affecting customers. So our initial Thanos deployment looked somewhat like this. We have Prometheus instances in highly available fashion with two replicas. We have sidecars shipping metrics to the S3 bucket. Thanos Query can query these Prometheus instances. And Thanos Query can also access the long-term storage data through the store gateway. Okay, so the next step would be to integrate this with the observe v cluster, which is running business applications. But as I mentioned, there were some problems that we faced, and sometimes you make mistakes and you will only be aware of them at a later point. So we were in this situation because we did not have Thanos mixing in place at this point. We integrated the Observer cluster with the Observer V cluster, and we had our compact component failing for days silently without any errors because these were not deployed. So our advice would be to always add monitoring as soon as your applications are functional to avoid situations like that. We added the Thanos mixins as two separate helm charts. We are using separate helm charts for actual dashboards and for recording rules and alerts. We are using helm charts nearly everywhere in our Kubernetes clusters, so we decided to use helm charts for this purpose as well. After we had this place, we could move forward with the actual integration. So we needed to update the target cluster's role to be to have Observe functionalities. This means that it could reference the S3 bucket that were created by the Observer cluster, and it would also create IAM roles for Prometheus to make the S3 bucket available. After that, we made the Observe Prometheus highly available by bumping the replica count to 2, and the Thanos components would take care of the duplicating the metrics by adding external labels to each Prometheus instance. But the actual implementation came with new questions: how to integrate this cluster with the Observer cluster. We have basically three ways to solve the cross-cluster integration. These are listed on this slide. The first one is a common solution, but you must individually expose all Thanos sidecars to access all store APIs. Therefore, you cannot put a single load balancer in front of them. You have to use separate ones for all sidecars. With the second option, you have a Thanos query instance that is discovering and connecting to sidecars in the local cluster, in the Observe cluster. The benefit of this approach is that you can expose only this query and have it queried from the Observer cluster's query. It sounds complicated, but the next slide will simplify it with an illustration. Or you can use receive. I will talk about this component later. Using this approach, you are basically pushing from the Observe cluster to the Observer's receive component. It has benefits, downsides. We will talk about this. So let's take a closer look at the second option. You can see a simplified implementation of stacking. So you have Thanos components deployed in the Observe cluster. This is something that you might not be prepared when you begin this journey, but actually it's much simpler exposing the Observe cluster this way, because as I mentioned, you only need to expose the query, and the Observe query will have the Thanos sidecars discovered locally, so you can save some infrastructure costs and complexity. But we had another issue at this point. We wanted to use different certificates cross-cluster and in-cluster. It's a common use case. You might not want to use the same certificates between clusters that you would use inside the cluster. Inside the cluster, you might want to just use self-signed certificates or no certificates at all. But currently there's a limitation and it's not possible. You can read about these limitations in the links in the footer. But fortunately, this can be worked around with more stacking. There's a blog post linked on this slide. You can find additional details, technical details on the per store TLS limitation, but I will highlight the details here. Basically, you can add a Thanos query that will have the integration with all your Thanos stack. You can integrate the compactor, the stores, the storage gateways to this centralized query and use that as a central piece. And for observe cluster integration, where you might want to use different production ready air certificates, you can deploy another query instance. This is called remote TLS query in this example, and you can stack these together. This way you can use different certificates, because this limitation is only relevant for query components. So in each query you can use a different certificate. So at this point we have meta monitoring in the observer cluster. It's highly available. We have integration with the observe cluster, that's also highly available, and we have metrics in an S3 bucket for both of these. At this point the next step is to have a proof of concept for Thanos Receive to test the on-premise integration out. We decided to deploy it in the development infrastructure first, and after the test just leave it there to have environment parity. So if you need to fine-tune any configuration or performance test the receive component, we can do this without affecting production workloads. Why we choose receive? Because as I mentioned, we are before a cloud migration. We wanted to have a simpler solution for these somewhat temporary on-premise clusters. As I mentioned, those workloads are not running in containers, so these are managed by Puppet, and migrating to those Prometheus solutions to Puppet managed Thanos solutions is a bit tedious, and there's no real benefit of making that migration if we are soon moving into the cloud. And those are also not highly available instances, so if we lose any of those during the migration, then that data center will not have monitoring until the issue is fixed. On the other hand, with receive we can just add remote write configurations, and the metrics will be shifted to our central cluster, and this is a much lower risk. And receive is seem to be a reliable solution, because you can specify replication factor, and it also has a local TSDB under the hood, the same as Prometheus. How receive works? Basically, the on-premise data centers are sending remote write requests. These are handled by the Thanos receive component. The remote write requests are stored locally in the TSDB, that is the same as the one that the Prometheus instances are using. Thanos receive exposing a store API for real-time queries, so it's queryable in real-time, and it's uploading these blocks in every 2 hours to the object store, so we have long-term retention as well. We had to performance tune and size the production and the development receive components. On the client side, you can you have to fine tune the remote write parameters. The max samples per send can be too low by default, it's sent to 100. This can be increased to avoid too frequent requests. It turned out that 5000 is much better for our use case, but I would recommend to use remote write and Thanos receive metrics and dashboards to find the optimal settings for your use case. Also, max shards should be lower to appropriate value when you are increasing the default max samples per send, which is basically batch size. And we experienced that having a higher cardinality tenant might need higher max samples per cent to avoid write failures on the receive component. There are some links on the footer. Please check those out before you are actually introducing a production receive instance. On the receiver side, you have the receive component. You will need to estimate the storage needed to store all your metrics. After some research, the research is linked in the footer again, we came up with this PromQL query, where you can give the query the retention, the ingested samples per second, and the actual bytes per sample. Then you will have to modify this with additional 20% of overhead because of the retention and the compaction overhead, and add an additional 5% because of the write ahead log, and by executing this query on a tenant you will get the estimated storage needed to store all your metrics for a given retention. At this point we have everything working in development environment, so we can move to production. The workflow is basically the same. You have to set up the observer and observee clusters, have the CloudFormation templates updated with its roles, so you have the bucket and the IAM roles in place. Then you can add meta-monitoring, move forward to cross-cluster integration, then to on-premise integration. Do not forget about the Thanos mixing charts to have monitoring and alerting for your monitoring. This is the production setup, so you might want to migrate your existing Grafana configurations and your dashboards that might be needed to have some transformation to have this new setup working well. You might need to add some additional labels to be able to specify the Prometheus instances that are ingesting data into the Thanos component. And we decided to expose this new Grafana with the Thanos component behind it side by side, so we can compare these together and have a backup if anything goes wrong. Post-implementation happened the following way. First we had in-team usage, so we were comparing it to the former vanilla Prometheus setup during day-to-day work and during outages, and see whether anything was different or not working or broken, for example. Then we started to invite beta users, teams for the developers team to try out and gather some feedbacks. After that we were holding some knowledge sharing sessions about the changes that were affecting the developers, our customers in this case, during this we were continuously monitoring the performance of the production and the development instances, and we were fine-tuning configurations where it was needed, and of course we were also collecting feedbacks and implementing these. Some statistics, results, and some words about our future. At this point we have around 3 million head series and we are ingesting almost 100 samples per second, and this will only grow as we will have the cloud migration started, so we will have some time to before the actual migration to make this solution scalable, but the foundation is already there and it's working and we are enjoying the benefits. This is the final architecture. You can see how everything works together, both on-premise and on cloud. You can see the protocols between each component. You can spend some time exploring this picture after the presentation, because there's a few components on this slide. And And what's next? We are planning to extend our automatic Grafana annotations that are marking releases and config changes on our Grafana dashboards. With Thanos under our new Grafana, we can have a dashboard that has all our infrastructures and components, and if all of our releases are marked as Grafana annotations, we can easily correlate releases to certain degradations or improvements. So that's a great thing to do, and we are really looking forward to have this functionality. We have some AWS managed services. We are planning to migrate the CloudWatch metrics to some kind of Prometheus CloudWatch exporter to have the benefits of having Thanos, so that we can correlate these metrics with Kubernetes and on-premise metrics and have alerts for these, and also long-term storage. And we are before cloud migration, so we are fine-tuning the configurations and optimizing performance to have it ready when the cloud migration works are starting. And we are already enjoying the more effective troubleshooting during on-calls. This presentation will be available as a detailed blog post, focusing on the technical details of the project, and you can find additional deep dive posts on Thanos under the Thanos tag on this website. Below that, there are all the external resources that I included in this presentation, so you can spend some time to explore those. Thank you for joining me in this presentation. You can reach me on these platforms, and now it's time for some Q&A.